living as if the purpose of life is to arrive safely at death. Run to the roar. Go after a dream that is destined to fail without divine intervention. Stop pointing out problems. Become part of the solution. Stop repeating the past and start creating the future. Face your fears. Fight for your dream. Grab opportunity by the mane and don't let go. Live like today is the first day and last day of your life. Burn sinful bridges and blaze new trails. Live for the applause of nail-scarred hands. Don't let what's wrong with you keep you from worshiping what's right with God. Dare to fail. Dare to be different. Quit holding out. Quit holding back. Quit running away. Chase the lion.
Hey, I'm so proud of you. Last week was our friend day, and we had a record attendance for this year already. 310 people were here worshiping God. Would you put your hands together? We need to celebrate that. We want to see this place packed out for the Lord and see a lot of people come to know Him and to be worshiping Him every single week. Well, I'm excited to continue our series, what we're calling the Lion Chaser. Lion Chaser. I hope you all become Lion Chaser. And where do we get this idea of Lion Chaser? Is that every one of you has a lion in your life, a dream, a passion, a desire that God has put on your life, and He's calling you to chase that lion. There's so many things that hold us back, our fears, our failures, all these things that say, maybe you can't do it, maybe you shouldn't do it, and all these things. But we want to kind of overcome those things and show you how to live with vibrant, lively faith and chase the dreams that God has for you. It comes out of 2 Samuel chapter 23. It's this little story about a guy by the name of Benaiah. And Benaiah is this character in Scripture who eventually becomes the commander over all of King David's armies. So he eventually becomes top dog, this amazing, famous warrior, and everybody knows his name, and everybody knows who he is, and he does great things for the Lord and great things for the king. But the story begins with this one decision, this one moment of courage where he literally chases a lion into a pit on a snowy day. Now, if you're like me, you're thinking, that's not what you're supposed to do, right? Like when you hear the roar of a lion, your brain just tells you, run the other direction, go somewhere else. But for Benaiah, the Lord just moved on his life. He made this one decision, one choice, and it forever changed the trajectory of his life because that became part of his resume, that this experience in his life became part of the story that would be his. And you have a story that God is writing in your life. If you have your Bibles, open up to Acts chapter 16. Now, I wasn't going to share this story with you, and I didn't have it in my plans, but as I was just praying through what I want to talk about with you today, I just felt like I needed to share this moment in Paul's life with you because it'll give more light to the Romans chapter 8 text that I want to give to you this morning. I'm going to teach you this morning. We're going to go deep. Is that okay? We're going to go deep today. I hope you're ready. I hope you got your waders on. We're going to go deep today. We're going to look at some scriptures. But I hope that it's so powerful in your life and life-giving to you. And at the end of the message, maybe you'll come and share with me that, hey, John, that was for you. And John, that was for me. Not for you. But yeah, that was for me. Thanks, Emily. All right. Acts chapter 16. One of my favorite stories in Scripture. Let me just give you the context of it. It is Paul and Silas. And Paul is probably the least likely person that you'd ever expect for God to do anything amazing in your life. He is a scoundrel. He's a very religious person. He was a Pharisee and he's a religious leader. And he's extremely religious, but he was not a good person. He was the least likely person you would ever expect to follow God or to follow Jesus or do anything great with his life. Even though he had fame and fortune and possessions and all this kind of stuff, he actually started a mob that would actually kill one of the very first Christians, Stephen. I mean, that's the kind of heart that this guy had, the mindset that he had. And then all of a sudden, we read in Scripture, he had this transforming experience where he sees Jesus and his life is forever changed. The trajectory of his life is forever changed. And God calls him, raises him up and says, I'm going to send you out to tell more people about Christ. And he just sends him out. And so this is one of those situations where Paul is being sent out. And he comes across this lady, this young girl who's being trafficked, who's being used. And she's got this spirit. We're not sure what kind of spirit it is, but she tells people their future. She tells people their future, and people are paying money. And her owners, she has owners who are exploiting her, taking advantage of her, and using her. And she can't get away. She's in slavery to them. And so Paul delivers her from this spirit, removes this spirit from her. Now, when she's able to tell the future, we don't know what that means. Maybe she actually was able to tell the future, or maybe this spirit was just, and she was able to just convince people that she could tell the future. We don't know what that spirit of manipulation was, of lying was, or whatever that was, but that spirit was removed from her. Paul removed that spirit, releasing her from that bondage, releasing her from that. And all of a sudden, now her owners are really, really upset. And her masters, verse 19, chapter 16, verse 19, her masters' hopes of wealth were now shattered. So they grabbed Paul and Silas and dragged them before the authorities at the marketplace. The whole city is in an uproar because of these Jews, they shouted to the city officials. They are teaching customs that are illegal for us Romans to practice, which wasn't even true. Verse 22, a mob quickly formed against Paul and Silas, and the city officials ordered them stripped and beaten with wooden rods. They were severely beaten, and then they were thrown into prison, and the jailer was ordered to make sure that they didn't escape. So the jailer put them into the inner dungeon and clamped their feet in the stocks. So here they are. God has sent them out. God has called them out. And here they are now in prison, doing the right thing, and now they're looking like failures. It's just unsuccessful. Here they are in the stocks. They have just been stripped down naked in front of everybody in the marketplace, completely humiliated, and then beaten with wooden rods. Just imagine how they're feeling right now. The pain that they are in, the wounds that they have. And it is this jailer's job to punish them. So they will never forget the day they visited his jail, the day that they walked into this town and stirred up trouble and did all these things. He woke up that morning to hurt somebody, and here's who he was going to hurt. And around midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and other prisoners were listening. That verse 25 is huge for me because it's probably not the reaction John would have. I would be screaming and crying, help me! You know, I'd be yelling. It'd be awful. It'd be awful. But that's not the response that they had. That's not how they saw the situation. Verse 26. Suddenly, there was a massive earthquake and the prison was shaken to its foundations. And all the doors immediately flew open and the chains of every prisoner fell off. And the jailer woke up to see the prison doors wide open. He assumed the prisoners had escaped, so he drew his sword to kill himself. But Paul shouted to him, stop, don't kill yourself. We are all here. See, he'd rather kill himself than face the repercussions of all of his prisoners being let go. Probably what would happen is he'd get what they deserved. He'd go into the prison. He'd get what they deserve. And Paul says, stop, we're all here. And the jailer called for the lights and ran to the dungeon and fell down trembling before Paul and Silas. And then he brought them out and asked, sirs, what must I do to be saved? They replied, believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved along with everyone in your household. And they shared the word of the Lord with him and with all who lived in his household. Even at that hour of the night, the jailer cared for them. Look at what? He's caring for them? And washed their wounds. Then he and everyone in his household were immediately baptized. I can't wait till Easter this year. We're going to be doing some baptisms. If you've not been baptized, can we baptize you? We would love for you to have that moment, to have that experience. And he brought them into his house. Now the jailer who woke up to punish them, to hurt them, he's bringing them home for dinner. And he sits before them and he and his entire household rejoice because they all believed in God. I mean, think of the moments, the transitions, the moments of Paul and Silas's adventure that night from being beat up, being beaten with rods to now all of a sudden there they are in the jailer's house, and everybody is worshiping the Lord. I mean, that is just a turn of events you cannot expect. It was that one decision, it was that one choice that Paul and Silas made, and now all of a sudden the whole world is turned upside down to the Punisher is now praising God. There's something powerful when you figure out what you were created for. Something amazing happens inside of you when you know that. What were you made for? What are you here for? Why are you still sucking air? What were you created for? As I've prepared for this series, this is the talk this morning that I just felt like God said, I just want you to teach this. I just want you to share this. And so what I'm going to share with you, I hope, is life-giving to you. I hope it opens. I hope some lights come on in your life about why God created you and why you're here. One of the most powerful things you will ever discover in your life is why you exist. Because once you understand why you exist, then you can define what success is. And what is success in our world? What is success to people that you know and that you care about? What is success for you? How do you define it when you know you've reached success? Success is tricky. Success is really hard to define and say, yep, got it. Today was a good day. Today was a Dean's now seven and just stays in this room, okay? Don't bring it up anywhere else. Just stays in this room. But Dean now, every day, at the end of the day, this day has been terrible. This is the worst day of my life. And I want to tell him as his father who loves him, wait for it, buddy. Wait for it. If you think this is bad, wait for it. This is nothing, okay? This is nothing to what you're going to go through. Hey, I read this definition of success this week, and it cracked me up. Let me share it with you. It goes like this. At age four, success is not peeing in your pants. And at age 12, success is having friends. At age 16, maybe many of you remember this, success is getting your driver's license. What a great day that was. At age 25, success is being married with the ability to have sex. At age 35, success is having money. At age 55, success is having a little bit more money. And at age 70, success is being married with the ability to have sex. And at age 80, success is having a driver's license. At age 85, success is having friends. And at age 90, success is not peeing in your pants. So that's true. So Dean, just wait for it, okay? Just wait for it, Dean. But when we don't know what we were created for, what we're here on earth for, then success looks really strange. And success is hard to define. And you don't even know if you're successful in marriage. You don't know if you're successful in your relationships with other people, friendships. You're not really sure if you're successful financially or in your career. How do you know you're successful in your career? Because your boss tells you so? Because you're going up? Some people chase success, only to wrestle it down and figure out that's not at all what they thought it was. How many people that we have to see go through suicide and die through suicide who had all these fame and fortune and things that we've all would work for? But it's not success. We have a whole world completely confused and broken in the idea of what success really looks like. And so Paul, who's just gone through this experience in Acts chapter 16, where he's been beaten, he's been put into prison, and then all of a sudden, God shows up. God shows up, and there's this huge earthquake. God causes this earthquake, and the chains fall off, and the doors open, and now the jailer who is just beating them and punishing them and hurting them is now worshiping and inviting them into his house, dressing his wounds, making a meal for him. Like, this is just crazy. How does this happen? Success changes. Success is redefined when we give our lives to Jesus. What we thought was success is reformatted, reshaped, redesigned, remodeled in our brains. So I want to talk about success today and what you were created for. And my hope would be that we would start a conversation. I can't end it today of what you were created for, but I'm just going to start the idea. And it may be an idea that changes the trajectory of your life. And maybe there's been a few things in your life that has changed the trajectory of your life, but this would be the thing that would draw you closer to God and you would just realize what you were made for and what success is all about. So that you would know what success is all about. That's what I want for you. Can I pray for you real quick? Heavenly Father, I just ask that you would speak through this moment. And you know that my brain feels really flustered and jumbled, and there's a lot of thoughts that I have and things that I want to share, but God, I think there's somebody here this morning that needs to hear from you and not from John Freed. And so I'm going to say, God, what you press into my heart. I'm going to just speak those things, and though they may not come out so clearly, I hope, God, that they would speak to someone in a powerful, powerful way today. We love you, Lord. And we want to see you. In Jesus' name, amen. So the book of Romans, Romans chapter 8, you can go there. Romans chapter 8 was written to a group of people. They were Roman Christians who were being persecuted, like Paul had been persecuted in that jail and been hurt for what he believed and what he was saying and what he was doing and how he was changing people's lives through the message and the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that's what Christians in Rome were starting to do. That's what Christians do. We share Christ. We reflect the glory of God to other people around us. And so they're being persecuted. And so Paul writes them this letter and explains to them, look, I know that you're losing, some of you are losing family and you're losing friends and you're losing your businesses that you've worked really hard for. You're losing your fortune. Or maybe you're losing your fame. Maybe there's a lot of things that you're losing in life, but you got to understand what you're gaining when you accept Jesus Christ, when you surrender your life to Christ. And so he sits down and he writes this teaching, this amazing deep teaching called Romans. And it's a letter to Romans about how to be a Christian in a modern world, how to be a Christian, how to follow God in every area of your life. And we get to Romans chapter 8, and this is a message just for you and me as well. So we're reading this, and I know you're thinking about the Romans being persecuted and these Christians who are losing everything, but you yourself, it is to change your life as well. So Romans chapter 8, verse 15. Verse 15 says this, and Zane, thank you so much for having the visuals up here today. It helps us all follow along. It says, so you have not received a spirit that makes you fearful slaves. So we don't need to live in fear or worry or anything like that. Instead, you received God's spirit when he adopted you as his own children. I mean, just picture that for a minute, that we are orphans without God in our life. And when we accept Christ into our life and we give our lives to him, this free gift, like you didn't have to earn it. He just loves you so, so much that God says, listen, this is the relationship that I want to have. It says, now we call him Abba Father. I just picture that for a minute, that he's Abba, little daddy, dad. He's the provider and he has provision for you and he loves you. He cares for you and he's the father that maybe you never had before. He's the father that you always needed. And God says, if I'm going to position myself anywhere in your life, it's going to be right here, Father. That deep, deep relationship and that connection, that who you are, your identity and the way that you look at life and the way that you view life is said, I created you and I have a purpose for you and I want you and I love you and I have something for you. I don't need anything from you. I have only something for you in this life and I've created you for a reason. He says, I'm Abba Father. It goes on and it says, for his spirit joins with our spirit to affirm, to promise us, to show us, to make it very clear and to affirm in us, encourage us, that we are God's children. And since we are God's children, we are heirs. Everybody say heirs. We are heirs. In fact, together with Christ, we are heirs of God's glory. Oh, I love that phrase. We are heirs to God's glory because we don't talk about God's glory all that much. And maybe no one's ever explained to you what God's glory is in your life. I want to draw it out to you as best as I can to draw God's glory to you. This is going to be a horrible drawing. It's going to be the worst drawing you ever see because I'm not going to be able to capture the glory of God. And the glory of God is this. The glory of God is the wow factor, okay? And if you ever want to experience success anywhere in your life, success in your marriage and success in your family, success in your finances, success in your career, in anything, if you want to be successful, here's the first fill in the blank. You got to realize, You got to realize the wow factor. And the wow factor is God's glory. God's glory. This idea that all that God is, his love and his holiness and it's just his manifestation of who God is, his faithfulness and his hope that we have in God, because he's everywhere and he's in control of everything and he's formed and created everything. I mean, you just look around, you can see God in creation. You can see God in the masses of the universe. I mean, just who God is. And God says, I have adopted you into that. I've pulled you into, gotta have that back. I got into who God is. I'm so excited about this, because when I realize the glory of God, and I haven't even really realized it, I've just come in contact with this idea that I am an heir. I am a child of God. So all that God has, all that God is, all that God desires to be, I get to be in that. I get to experience that. Write these three words down. I get to experience that. I get to see the evidence of that. And I get to express that. See, God's will for your life is God's glory in your life. The wow factor. The wow factor. We call Diana our little princess. She is. She's the princess. But not because I'm the king. Now, granted, she's my little daughter. She's 5 years old this week. Gonna turn five. Little girl. Oh. My little girl's turning five. Let's just stop and pray for John. We call her the princess because she's the daughter of the Father, her King, God. Now, I'm her earthly father, right? So she's my princess as well, and I get to be the king of my little house. And you're like, wow, that's a wow. The wow factor of John's not all that wow. Let's just be honest, okay? But I've got a little wow factor myself, okay? I got some gifts and some talents and some things that I can do for Diana. She want a Pop-Tart? I can get her a Pop-Tart. She want a ride to school? She gets a ride to school in my 2016 minivan that the windows in the back somehow doesn't open anymore. When I do get it open, it slants down. I have no idea what's wrong with it, but it's stuck open now, okay? That's the John Fried wow factor. The wow factor for me is not that wow. But she also has a Father in heaven. I want her to realize that. I want her to see that there's a wow factor in her heavenly Father that her earthly Father can never give her. And inside of each one of us, we deeply desire and we were created to hold and to be a part of and to step into the wow factor that is of our heavenly Father. And some of you have stepped in the wow factor trying to find that glory that you know you desperately need in your life. And you've tried to find that wow factor in other people, other places, other things, and none of it is gonna feel like success. None of it is going to feel like the glory that the Father has for you. And so his complete desire is that you would know and that you would experience and that you it would be just be wow of who God is in your life. Every single moment of every single day that you would step into your Father's house, it is your birthright to experience and to know and to have the expression of God's glory in every area of your life. The Bible tells us you are an heir to the King. So live like it. God says you are an heir, and you get to see God's glory in every area of your life. Do you realize that? Because when you wake up tomorrow morning, you may not feel the glory of God. You may not feel the glory of God. Why not? Because we're stuck in a world that sucks. It does. It sucks the life out of us. It sucks the joy out of us. There's brokenness all around us. That's why God, the Father, who loves you so much, sent his Son so that through Christ we can have this glory. So through Christ we can share in God's glory. It's your destiny. It's your birthright. It's what you were created for to hold and to be a part of and to experience God's glory in your life. But if you're like me, you don't always feel it, see it, realize it because of life. Here's the second way. Second thing says this. We have to relinquish control. We have to relinquish the control factor. There is a wow factor, but there's also a control factor. Verse 17, but we are to share His glory. We must also share His suffering. That's what verse 17 says. If we're going to share in the glory, then we have to be prepared, Paul says, to share in the suffering. So the glory is, man, I get to cast out this demon, like, whoa, her life is totally changed. But then all of a sudden, there is this suffering that takes place. And so he's writing to these Christians who live in Rome and now being persecuted. They're being sent out. They're losing everything. They're saying, whoa, I thought when I asked Jesus in my life, the glory, the heavens were going to open up and I get to experience His glory. What is this? And Paul says, look, to experience the glory, you have to experience the suffering as well. You have to give up control, and that's the suffering. You have to relinquish and surrender and say, God, I need to give you this suffering. Christ, before He goes on the cross for our sins, and before He was going to be raised from the dead. We'll talk about experiencing God's glory. Is that you were dead for 3 days and now, boom, you're back alive again. That is God's glory being worked out and being active in Christ's life. And says, you're heirs to that. You get to be a part of that. You get to experience that. Death is not the end for you. But remember that Jesus was in a garden before He was in a tomb. He was in a garden and He was saying it was suffering and there was pressure and there was tension. Jesus said, if you want to follow Me, you have to be willing to take up your cross and follow Me. Not your crown, your cross. Because look, in your life, there are, write it down, trials. There are tensions. God gives us these things, these trials and these tensions, so that we can submit to strengthen. Submit to strengthen. Write it down. Submit to strengthen. He doesn't hold back the struggles in life from you. Sometimes He does. Sometimes He'll put a hedge of protection. But I believe that God allows for these things to come into our lives because those are moments in which you can experience His glory in your life. See, Romans 8 that we've been reading later on, verse 28 says this. It says this. We know that God causes everything. Everybody say everything. The good and the bad and the ugly. Everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to His purpose for them, that God has a purpose for your life. And the good and the bad and the ugly, God's going to use it all. He uses our trials and our tensions. If we relinquish it, if we give Him these things that are hurting us, that we're suffering, because if we don't go through the suffering, then God can't do something supernatural. God's wow factor cannot be evident or experienced in our life. That in that time of suffering, God's glory is so evident and so real and so powerful, and the people around us get to see it. When we start to reformat the problems in our life to possibilities, see, God wants to take your problems, your greatest problems, and make them and supernaturally change them into your greatest opportunities to experience Him. He wants to take your greatest problems and make them the greatest places where He is evident to you. And He wants to take your greatest problems and make them Your greatest possibility is for someone to see God in you. So what's your greatest problem? What's your greatest problem? You know what it is. You worry about. It keeps you up at night. We all got them. If you're going to share in the glory, you got to share the sufferings. Meaning, could you take that greatest trial, that greatest tension, or even maybe it's a little trial, a little tension, and would you relinquish it to God and say, look, I've tried to fix this, carry this on my own wow factor. And the truth is, I am not enough wow for this. I'm not going to pull this out. I'm not going to be able to figure this out. Would your glory come here? I give it to you because there's nothing more I can do with it. There's been so many instances in my life where I've prayed prayers of comfort and safety and not prayers to experience God's glory. There's been prayers where I said, Lord, the doctors think it's this and this. Would you not let it be that? Maybe God is saying, John, there's so much more I have for you than this. Suffering. You're trying to live safely until the day you die. Like everything's all comfortable and hunky-dory until the moment you die. And that's just not reality, Dean. If you think this is the worst day of your life, you don't know life. What if we give it to God and He could strengthen us in it? What if the purposes and the things that we have to go through in life, that we're going to need strength? And so there has to be this breaking down of our spirit, this breaking down where God said, okay, now I'm going to reshape you and I'm going to reform you. And you, this horrible event that happened in your life, watch this. I'm going to make it awesome. I'm going to make it good. I'm going to put my glory into it. And you're going to say, the only way that worked out and the only way I can stand here today is because of the glory of God in my life, not the wow factor of John. Because just let's be honest, there is no wow factor to this. We have to have the Holy Spirit and Christ and the Father and their provision and providing and all the things that God wants to do in our life. We need God's glory in me, in this trial and tension. I got nothing for it. I got nothing I can do about it. All I can do is go, that, be there, be there. And the Spirit affirms us and reminds us that you are not alone. Who are you? You are a child of God, created for a purpose and a reason. And when you are in suffering, He is right there with you. When you are in chains, in a prison, in a dungeon, and you're stripped down naked, and you've been beat, and you've been, what do you do? Here's what Paul says. Zoom out. Yesterday, I tried to take a video of my son playing basketball. I zoomed in too far, and all I see is just movement. Nothing going on. I have no idea what's happening. When we zoom out from our problems, and the way that we zoom out is this. Write this down. We pray and we praise. That's what Paul did. We pray and we praise. Now we can say, God, I need you here. What am I not seeing? We just start having a conversation with God. That's why we did 21 days of prayer. That's why we started the whole year with this frequency series that we just got done teaching, so that you could zoom out from your problems, from your trials, and you could see the opportunities, you could see the possibilities that the Lord is able to speak those things into you. And He may not show you your entire future. He'll just give you a little breadcrumb. Do this. And it might be a big risk and a big decision that you have to make. But God says, I know it's going to be tough. I know there's going to be some suffering in this, but trust me as your Abba Father. I will be there. And all the stuff you're going to go through, let me be your Savior. Stop looking at your problems and focus on Christ And then we start praising. Look what Paul does. He prays in that dungeon, and then he sings. That's why we sing every week at this church. Why do we sing at this church? Why do we sing at this church? You don't sing anywhere else. You're not walking around Walmart like, sing along with me. Ah, God Almighty, glory, 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 right? You're not doing that in the drive-thru at McDonald's or anything like that. I hope you're not doing that at your kids' basketball games. It'll freak everybody out. We sing at church. We sing at church because we want to experience God's glory in our deepest, biggest problems. We want to submit so that he can strengthen us. Strengthen us. Philippians 4, 6 says, don't worry about anything. Everybody say, anything. And when you read that, in my mind, there's a little voice that goes, yeah, right. Yeah, right. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and praise him. Thank him for all he has done. When was the last time you just said, Lord, I'm going to zoom out from my problems and just go, hey, thank you that I even have a minivan that runs down the road. Thank you that I have a road. Thank you that I have a house. Thank you that I have a bed to sleep on to put my big prideful head on every single night. Thank you that I have breath in my lungs. Thank you that when I'm sick, I got medicine and doctors. Thank you that you are a part, like just start thanking God and you will be amazed at how you're able to zoom out and go, wow, you really are an almighty God. There really is God's glory all around. I got to finish it up. Here's the other three T's. The other three T's are this. Time, talent, treasures. Time, talent. Amen, amen. That baby's telling me, amen. I hear him. Time, talent, treasures. You see, every one of us gets these three things so that we can steward, write this down, steward to significance. Steward to significance. Ephesians 2:10 says, we are his workmanship, meaning God the Father, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them, that we should walk in them. How many of you want to do something amazing for the Lord? You want to do something amazing for God? You want to do something amazing with your life? Anybody? Yeah, yeah. Here's some good news. That's not your job. That's not your job. It's not yours job. How many of you want to be amazing parents? Yep. How many of you want to be amazing parents? Yeah, not your job. Isn't that good news? Good news. My job, though, is to be a steward of what God has given me, though. A good steward of my time. I get 24 hours. How much do you get? Do you own it? Do you give it back to God and say, God, I got 24 hours today. What do you want me to do with it? It's all yours. I'm going to relinquish control over my time to you. Some of you are like, I don't have time to pray. I don't have time to read the Bible. I don't have time to go to life group. We're busy people, John. We're so busy. Yeah? Doing what? What wow thing are you doing? What if you just said, God, you have my time to be wow in it? Because the time I've been using has not been all that wow. I need you to have my time so that you can be wow in it. Experience your glory in it. Or your talent. Some of you are talented people and you've used all that talent for yourself. What's the talent God's given you? He gave you that talent so that you could experience his wow in your life, the glory of God in your life. How could you use that talent for the Lord? That you would steward it so it's not just for yourself, but for significance. So what significant thing, God, could you use my talent for? Because I'm going to use it for myself, and I want to use it for you. I want to give glory, experience your glory, express your glory through this. What's your talent? You write it down. What's your talent? And then finally, your treasures. You got some treasures. And God says, can I have it all? How do we use our resources, our finances, our stuff? A lot of us live for those things. We get up every day to work hard so we can have what? More stuff. God says, I give you everything. You didn't. Your wow factor didn't get what you got. My wow factor, my glory in your life has given you. And you say, well, I need more. I know. But if I give you more, you're going to think it's all your wow and not my wow. So steward what I've given you. And when you steward that towards significance, you relinquish control of it and say, God, you got control of it. It's all yours. And you'll see my glory. Because you're an heir to it. It's all yours. I'm going to show up in your life you never thought possible before. I think these five areas we hold on to like this. We hold on to these things in our life. Maybe it's our trials. Maybe it's the tension that we have. We think, I got to do it all on my own. It's all on my shoulders. It's all me today. Me, me, me. And all about my wow factor. What can I do? And what can I figure out? And how can I do this? And we hold on so tightly to our talent and to our treasure and to our time. Man, we got our calendar and it's all organized. We got all of our stuff. It's all organized. And all that pressure is on you. And you're holding so tightly. And maybe God wants to say to you today, would you give me your trials? What is that thing in your life you've been holding on to and saying, could you give it to me? Enough of your wow, my wow. And would you give me your tension? Would you give me your talent and your treasure? Sometimes we hold on to something in our life. We're like, yeah, praise the Lord, but God says, you haven't given me all of it. And because you hold on, you can't receive. So there's glory for you in your life. And you know exactly where God wants to give it. Would you stand with me? Stand with me. We're going to sing a song I want you to receive in your heart today. But to receive it, you have to realize the wow of God in your life. Realize that it's there for you. He's not holding out to you. The Lord has never told you no. He wants to tell you yes. And you've got to relinquish some control. Some of you are control freaks. And to experience the control, the wow factor, you have to relinquish the control factor. And some of you, that's so hard. You've been holding on to something in your life. And God says, can I have it? Because as much as I love you, I don't want you to struggle. I don't want you to suffer. I want to share the glory and share the suffering. Would you relinquish it to me? Would you give it to me? And there's a moment in every one of our lives where we just say, yeah, or we say no. We're going to sing this song. I hope it's an opportunity for you to know what that risk would be, what that decision would be to relinquish control over that thing in your life. When Dean was born, I was standing in Riverview and I'm holding my boy, my firstborn son, my Dean. And I knew the Lord had called me to plant a church. I was so scared because I had a comfortable, I had everything under control. I had a great career. I had a great thing going. I just was holding on. And the Lord was slowly asking me to relinquish this and that and this and that. And so here I am and I'm holding Dean and I realize, man, look at God, what you did. What you made for me. You made this for me? I could hear him saying, I want you to steward this, John. Where'd that marker go? Forget it. It's gone. So I want you to steward this. And I realized in my heart, in that moment, that this little boy was going to grow up and realize that his father was a wimp. And see, I saw the smallness of my wow factor when I saw the glory of God's. I felt really little. And I realized I was holding on to some things. And I needed to relinquish those things. For God to start a movement in Hamilton County, he had to be willing He'd be able to start a movement in me. Or say, just give it all to God. Give it all to the Lord. And I didn't want Dean to grow up and see that I said all these things, but then I actually lived them out. That I told him all these things, but never really showed it to him. I realized that the fear in me was far greater than the faith in me. 20 days after Dean was born, I resigned my job and said, we're going to do this. We're going to see God move. I want to see God's glory. Even if I fail to the world's standards, I'm successful to God because I was obedient. He's going to show up. I trust him. What about you? Where do you want to see God's glory in your life? Say yes and relinquish it all to him. Or say no this morning and say, I still have to hold on to this. It's a big decision. Like chasing a lion into a pit on a snowy day. Let's pray. Your love never fails us. Your faithfulness is always with us. Your hope never dissipates because your glory is all around us. As Isaiah said, the prophet, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. And the earth is filled with his glory. God, we want to experience all that you have for us and all that you are in every area of our lives. And so God, in the words of Paul, when he says to share in the glory, we got to share in the suffering. I ask God that we would surrender to you today. Every area, every problem, so that you can reformat it, change it, reshape it with your glory. Our eyes would be open, and the heavens would open up, and your spirit would fall upon us in every area of our life. God, we give you all of us. Work it out. Allow us to say, wow, God. Wow, God. Wow, God. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's worship. Let's worship together. Hey, to all of our friends who are watching online, welcome to the journey. At Waterline, we believe that everybody's on a spiritual journey. What we want to do is journey with you. If today's talk spoke to you in any way, would you please let us know that? You can email us at WTLN@waterlinechurch.com. Share with us your story. One of our pastors would be excited to connect with you. Thank you so much for watching and sharing this message online. Continue to share it around to your friends and family members as we continue to grow together and change the world.